Today, we will be meeting with CEOs of two Korean beauty brands that are more popular overseas than here in Korea. Coincidentally, they both started their businesses around the same time, a decade ago. We will first be meeting with Sungho Park, founder and CEO of Whoosh Company, which has a vegan-friendly brand called Dear Claire's, and a more reactive brand created based on customer feedback called Buy Whoosh Trend. Their success is mainly attributable to its YouTube channel, which is widely popular among global consumers. It has 1.65 million subscribers as of today and had received the gold play button in 2019, given to those with over 1 million subscribers. We will be exploring how they successfully won over the hearts of millions and why they think content is so crucial to their business. Next, we will be speaking to Hyungseok Dino Ha, CEO and founder of Mimi Box, now renamed as MBX. The company, which began with a monthly subscription box business, became the first Korean company to receive investment from Y Combinator. With the Y Combinator investment, the company moved its headquarters from Seoul to the Silicon Valley and has offices in Taipei, Shanghai, and Seoul, which still remains the largest. MBX now has 6 product lines, one of which was co-developed with Sephora. With Dino Ha, we will be talking about how he was able to successfully bring his business to the US and expand to other markets, what his challenges were, what he thinks makes K-Beauty so special, and how his experience at Parsons led him to where he is now.
Ah, 네. 저는 위식 컴퍼니 대표를 맡고 있는 네, 박성호라고 합니다. 네, 반갑습니다. 저희 회사는 이제 뷰티 브랜드, 컨텐츠, 커머스를 만든다라고 회사를 정의를 하고 있고요. 스킨케어라는 카테고리를 어렸을 때부터 좀 피부 고민이 많아서 관심을 많이 갖고 있었던 영역이었고, 제가 좀 이제 대학교 때부터 창업을 했었거든요. 하면서 언젠가 좀 사회 경험을 더 쌓고 나면 창업을 해봐야 되겠다는 생각을 갖고 있었고, 그리고 제가 좀 창업했던 시기가 이제 국내의 화장품 어떤 인프라가 막 갖춰지는 시점, 그 다음에 해외로 뭔가 기회들이 열리는 시점이어서 이때 이런 제가 하고 싶었던 사업 분야를 창업을 해보면 좋겠다 이런 생각을 갖고 창업을 하게 됐습니다. 중학교 때부터 시작됐던 이제 여드름 이제 고민이 좀 많았었고요. 지금도 그런데 약간 지성이다 보니까 사실 뭐 모공, 여드름 이런 고민들이 많았고, 그래서 좀 그때부터 이렇게 좋다라고 하는 화장품, 스킨케어들을 계속 찾아서 사용했던 것 같아요. 제가 창업하고 이제 10년 차가 됐는데도 지금도 화장품 매장 가서 새로운 제품들 보고 새로운 브랜드 보면 여전히 굉장히 네, 열광하고요. 지금은 이제 출장을 자주 가지는 못하지만 예전에 출장을 갈 때 생각해보면 이제 대형 화장품 뭐 매장 이런 데 들어가면 보통 뭐 1시간에서 1시간 반씩 네네 거기에 있어요. 네. 이제 위식 컴퍼니가 사업을 시작하는 단계가 이제 미디어들의 조금씩 변화가 막 생기기 시작하는 즈음이었어요. 그리고 모바일이 굉장히 빠르게 팽창하던 시기였고, 그래서 이제 제가 주목했던 건 사실 그동안의 화장품 회사들이 갖고 있던 공식, 뭔가 대형 모델을 사용하고 이제 매스미디어 광고를 활용하면 빠르게 인지도와 신뢰도를 확보할 수 있는 방식이 점점 어려워질 수 있겠다라고 생각을 했었고, 근데 모바일이나 온라인에서는 사실은 광고를 내가 오래 봐야 될 이유가 사실 없잖아요. 그래서 저희는 이제 그들이 광고에 사용하는 만큼을 이제 컨텐츠로 예, 전환을 해서 고객들한테 다가가 보면 어떨까라고 생각을 했던 것 같아요. 그래서 저희는 이제 어떻게 보면 처음에 이제 브랜드 회사로 출발해서 이제 그 다음에 브랜드 회사에 이제 컨텐츠를 같이 결합을 하고 지금 이제 커머스 단계까지 넘어온 네, 과정이라고 봐주시면 될 것 같아요. 그래서 좀 꾸준히 컨텐츠를 계속 만들고 있습니다. 이제 아무래도 저희 소비재 영역에 해당이 되다 보니까 고객들이 어디에서 시간을 보내는지에 관심을 많이 갖고 있고요. 그 당시에 이제 모바일이 팽창하면서 고객들이 많이 시간을 보내는 곳이 소셜미디어였고, 소셜미디어에서도 좀 컨텐츠 소비를 많이 하고 이제 점유 시간이 막 늘어나던 곳이 유튜브였어요. 그래서 여기에 우리가 조금 더 빨리 진입하면 기회가 있겠다라고 판단을 해서 좀 고객들한테 좀 시간을 여기에서 쓰거나 저희 컨텐츠를 봐도 좀 가치가 있을 만한 컨텐츠들을 네, 계속 꾸준히 만들었던 것 같아요. 그냥 단순히 광고 영상을 만들지 않고 저희가 공부하고 있는 스킨케어에 대한 영역들을 계속 전달을 하려고 노력을 하고 있거든요. 그래서 저희가 해외에서 이제 뭐팬 미팅, 아, 팬 미드업 행사나, 네, 아니면은 이제 좀 고객분들이랑 이제 댓글로 소통을 할 기회가 있어서 보면, 뭔가 알려줘서 고맙다. 나를 어떤 내가 몰랐던 복잡했던 스킨케어에 대해서 좀 쉽게 설명해줘서 고맙다는 피드백을 굉장히 많이 듣는데, 그런 부분들과 같이, 네, 이어지지 않을까라고 생각을 합니다. 저희가 계속 이제 시리즈들을 만들고 있는데요. 그 어떻게 사용하면은 스킨케어 어떻게 사용하면 좋고 어떻게 사용하면 이제 저희가 생각할 때좀 효율적이지 않거나 효과적이지 않다. 뭐 이런 식의 컨텐츠들을 만들기도 하고요. 제가 고민이 많았던 여드름처럼 실제로 저희 고객분들이 여드름 고민이 많으시거든요. 그래서 여드름과 어떻게 싸워가는지 하는 시리즈도 있고. 네, 계속 그다음에 최근에는 사실 고객분들이 성분에 관심이 많아지면서 성분에 대한 얘기들도 좀 꾸준히 하고 있어요. 좀 기본에 대한 이야기 많이 하려고 하고 있어요. 여전히도 스킨케어, 뭐 예를 들면 클렌징을 왜 해야 되느냐, 꼼꼼히 클렌징 해야 되는 이유는 무엇인가, 뭐 모이스처라이저를 어떻게 써야 되느냐, 뭐 이런 부분에 대한 좀 기본적인 컨텐츠들, 최근에 뭐 어떤 트렌드들 이렇게 같이 좀 믹스해 보려고 노력하고 있습니다. 이렇게 많은 게 맞물려 있는 것 같아요. 그래서 일단 크게 보면은 이제 국내에 있는 생산 인프라가 굉장히 좋고요. 그래서 뭐 언제든지 뭐 어떤 제품을 만들고 싶다라고 하면은 만들어낼 수 있는 곳이 저는 한국이라고 생각을 하고, 그리고 또 하나는 한국 소비자분들이 스킨케어에 관심이 많고 굉장히 제품을 고르는데도 민감하신 분들이 많으세요. 이제 그러다 보니까 그런 목소리들을 계속 브랜드들이 반영을 하려다 보니까 이제 계속 고객 친화적인 제품들이 계속 나오고 있고요. 그리고 한국 그 시장 자체가 이제 한 업체들이 한 3만 개가 넘거든요. 그러다 보니까 굉장히 경쟁적이고, 네. 이제 그 안에서 생기는 이제 긍정적인 효과라고 한다면 이제 창의적인 제품들이 계속 나오는 것 같아요. 네. 해외에서 봤을 때는 되게 신선하면서도 되게 좋은 컨텐츠인 것 같아요. 못 보던 제품이 나오기도 하고, 아니면 같은 제품을 되게 다르게 사용하기도 하고, 네. 그리고 좀 생산되는 축이나 신제품이 나오는 속도가 굉장히 빠르고요. 네. 그런 것들이 이제 굉장히 신선하게 다가오고 있지 않나? 네, 그렇게 생각합니다. 2000년 후반쯤이지 않을까라고 생각을 좀 하고요. 그러니까 막 엄청난 이렇게 여러 가지 요소들은 있는 것 같아요. 뭐 한국 문화가 막 전해질 수 있는 어떤 케이팝과 같은 계기도 있었고, 그때가 이제 갤럭시라는 스마트폰이 등장하면서 사실 전 세계 많은 사람들이 메이드 인 코리아 제품을 하나씩 들고 다니게 됐었고, 그러면서 한국이 자연스레 조망을 받았던 어떤 분위기, 그때 마침 이제 어떤 화장품 인프라 산업적인 어떤 성장, 이게 딱 맞물렸던 시기가 2000년 후반쯤인 것 같고, 이제 그때부터 계속 여러 가지 이슈들과 뭐 중국에서의 수출의 성장이라든지 뭐 결정적인 좀 모멘텀들도 있었던 것 같아요. 네. 이제 저희가 처음에 이제 그 사업을 시작할 때 생각해 보면은 아까 말씀드린 것처럼 좀 어떤 대형 광고, 대형 유통에 의존하던 패러다임을 좀 바꿔보고 싶었고, 그걸 바꾸면서 저희가 시도를 하기에는 한 나라에서 뭐 많은 마켓셰어를 가져가긴 어렵다고 판단했어요. 그래서 좀 그러면 이제 저희가 공략했던 건 이제 각 나라의 니치 마켓을 공략을 하되, 그러면 이제 규모가 너무 안 나오니까 이제 마켓을, 네, 여러 곳으로 펼쳐서 접근을 해보자였고, 거기에는 사실 한국도 포함이 되어 있어요. 저희는 사실 한국도 같은 비중을 두고 중요성을 둬서 마케팅을 해왔었고, 근데 이제 어떤 특정 국가들에서 조금 더 반응이 있었고, 뭐 이제 모든 회사가 그렇지만 사실 반응이 나오는 국가에 좀더 리소스를 집중하게 되고, 그런 과정이었던 것 같습니다. 초반에는 저희가 미국에서 반응이 좋았었고, 그 후에는 좀 유럽에서 반응이 좋았고, 최근에는 이제 인도나 좀 아시아권에서 반응이 좋습니다. 미국 같은 경우는 아무래도 저희가 컨텐츠를 계속 영어로 만들어 왔던 영향이 좀 컸던 것 같고요. 그다음에 유럽에서는 저희가 시작점은 사실 또 유럽에서도 영어를 좀잘 사용하는 국가들이 북유럽에서 먼저 출발점이 만들어졌거든요. 그래서 이게 딱뭐 어떤 데이터로 증명할 수 있는 부분은 아닌데, 좀 자연스럽게 저희가 컨텐츠가 퍼지면서, 예, 그에 맞춰서 좀 움직여 오지 않았었나? 그래서 실제로 저희 유튜브나 이런 쪽에서 좀 데이터들을 보면 그 흐름에 맞춰서 좀 트래픽들이 나오고 있어요. 저희가 재작년부터 뭐 일본어, 베트남어, 인도네시아어 이렇게 컨텐츠를 만들기 시작을 했고요. 그다음에 앞으로도 이제 좀뭐 러시아어, 뭐 좀뭐 아랍어 뭐 이렇게 해서 좀 다양하게 좀 컨텐츠를 만들어 가려고 생각을 하고 있습니다. 아무래도 이거는 마켓의 환경 영향인 것 같고, 이제 전 세계에서 이제 그 당시에는 저희가 중국 시장을 뭐 지금도 그렇지만 이제 메인리 보지 않았다 보니까 가장 큰 시장, 그 다음에 가장 많이 사용한 언어에 좀 초점을 맞춰서 했던 것 같아요. 아무래도 벤처 회사였고 리소스가 충분하지 않으니까 이제 가장 가능성이 높은 곳에 좀 집중했다라고 보시면 맞을 것 같아요. 사실 제일 어려운 과정 중 하나더라고요. 그러니까 저희 회사가 그래도 뭐 여러 가지 좋은 상황과 좋은 동료들, 그다음에 뭐 여러 가지 운을 만나서 이렇게 계속 성장을 할 수는 있었는데, 이렇게 하드웨어적으로 따라온다는 게 굉장히 어렵다는 거를 사실은 많이 느끼고 있어요. 그래서 뭐 어떤 때는 이제 좀 오랜 동안 제품이 품절이 걸리기도 하고, 또 어떤 때는 또 맞추기도 하고 하면서 계속 이렇게 가고 있는 중인 것 같아요. 근데 이게 예전에는 이게 그냥 수요만 있으면 바로 공급이 따라와야 되는 거 아닌가라는 생각을 저도 했는데, 이 산업을 계속 해보면서 이렇게 확실히 이렇게 하드웨어적으로 따라와 주는 게 굉장히 어렵다는 걸 많이 느끼고 있습니다. 재작년까지는 그래도 막 이렇게 되게 심각한 이슈는 아니었는데, 이제 코로나 때 조금 이제 생산단에서 좀뭐 여러 가지 이유들로 좀 딜레이 됐던 경우들이 있는데, 그때부터 좀더 심각하게 생각을 하기 시작한 것 같아요. 뭐 물류가 막혔었던 때도 있고, 저희 특정 원료들이 수급이 원활하지 않았었던 때도 있고, 경험을 하면서 아 진짜로 저희가 이 서플라이 체인 잘 관리해야 되는구나를 많이 배웠던 한 해였습니다. 일단은 계속 고객분들이 저희한테 이제 요청 주시는 내용, 댓글에 남겨주시는 내용은 결국 피부 고민이세요. 그러면 이제 그분들의 고민을 듣고 고민에 저희가 좀 이제 응하는 이제 제품이라고 생각을 하고 있고, 어떤 뭐 유기적인 연결성보다는 이제 저희가 고객분들의 목소리가 여기에 높다라고 했을 때그 응하는 제품을 만들려고 노력을 하고 있습니다. 그러니까 저희가 첫 번째 이제 저희 브랜드로 이제 디어 클레어스라는 브랜드가 있었고, 아무래도 민감성 피부를 대상으로 그다음에 좀더 심플한 스킨케어를 제안하는 브랜드 컨셉을 가지고 있다 보니까 아무래도 저희가 모든 스킨케어를 채워줄 수가 없었어요. 그리고 나서 저희가 위스트렌드닷컴이라는 이제 글로벌 크로스보더 커머스를 오픈을 했는데, 이제 고객분들이 이제 자연스럽게 저희 뭐 이제 유튜브 구독자분들도 계속 늘어나시고, 이제 커머스 오시는 분들도 늘어나시면서 요청사항들이 계속 생긴 거죠. 이런 제품도 있으면 좋겠다, 난 이럴 때쓸수 있는 제품도 있으면 좋겠다라는 이제 질문들이 많아졌고, 그러면 디어 클레어스가 못하는 빈 영역들을 바이스트랜드에서 좀더 고객분들한테 다가갈 수는 없을까 이렇게 생각을 했었고, 그래서 대표적으로는 이제 디어 클레어스의 베스트셀러 중에는 이제 그 비타민 세럼, 비타민 드롭이라는 비타민 세럼 제품이 있는데, 약간 저희가 이제 민감성 고객들을 위해서 어떻게 보면 조금은 낮은 농도의 5% 정도의 비타민 C를 함유한 제품인데요. 이제 고객분들은 굉장히 고농도의 제품을 원하는 분들이 많음을 알고, 이제 바이오스트랜드에서 첫 번째 제품은 21.5%를 넣었던 21.5 세럼이라는 제품이에요. 근데 산업에 대해서 들어와서 이제 처음 접하게 된건 이제 동물 실험과 관련된 부분이었고, 근데 동물 실험이 지금은 사실은 동물 실험 금지가 법제화가 돼서 모든 화장품 브랜드들이 동물 실험을 못 하는데요. 그 당시는 이제 동물 실험을 이제 원하면 할수 있었던 시기였고, 근데 이제 저희가 이제 고객분들이랑 계속 소셜미디어 등을 통해 소통을 하면서, 이제 최근에는 더 많이 익숙해진 현상인데, 이제 고객분들이 이제 브랜드 입장을 물었던 경험들이 있어요. 그래서 그 당시 좀 첨예했던 입장 중에 하나가 이제 특정 국가에 진출을 하기 위해서 동물 실험을 꼭 받아야 되는 상황이 있었는데, 그걸 너희는 할 생각이냐라는 질문이었고, 제가 그 질문을 이제 전달받고 굉장히 많은 고민을 해서 왜 이런 질문을 할까? 왜 해서 좀 공부를 많이 해봤죠. 저희 뭐 이렇게 보셔서 아시겠지만 이렇게 공부하고 책 읽고 이런 걸 좋아하다 보니 공부를 해보면서 동물 실험이 아, 이 산업에 굉장히 이슈가 있는 내용이고, 그 동물 실험과 연계돼서 자연스럽게 생각됐던 부분이 이제 비건과 관련된 부분이었어요. 그럼 굳이 동물성 원료를 써야 될까까지로 저희가 생각이 확장이 되면서, 그러면 한번 동물 실험은 저희가 원래 처음부터 하지 않았었고, 뭐 계속 그때도 할 생각이 없었다라고 저희가 방침을 정하고 있었기 때문에, 그러면 저희가 동물성 원료도 사용을 하지 않을 수 있지 않을까? 네, 라고 생각하고 이제 그때부터 좀더 진지하게 들여다봤던 것 같아요. 그래서 저희가 그 당시에 동물성 원료를 사용하고 있진 않았 사용하고 있는 제품들이 거의 없었는데, 이제 과 관련된 원료들이 좀 있었어요. 그래서 그 제품들을 다 이제 식물성으로 전환하는 과정들을 계속 지난 몇 년간 했었고요. 네. 그냥 특징적인 거는 이제 한국 비건 인증원이 처음 생기면서 저도 굉장히 반가운 소식이었는데, 이제 거기에서 저희가 1호로 이제 비건 인증을 받은 이제 화장품이었다는 게 조금 저희한테 의미도 있고, 그다음에 사실은 이런 인증 제도가 계속 발전해 가려면 저는 한국에도 그런 기관들이 계속 필요하다고 생각을 하거든요. 그래서 지금 한국에서 저희가 인증을 받고 있고, 이제 해외 기관, 해외에서 좀더 익숙한 기관에서도 계속 인증을 받아가는 과정. 회사에서는 제가 제일 많이 강조했던 조직에서의 키워드는 적응력이었어요. 저희 산업에서 변화가 굉장히 빠르고, 특히 저희가 이제 주로 판매하거나 고객들하고 소통하고 있는 채널이 디지털이 뭐 지난 10년간 사실 굉장히 빠르게 변화하는 모습들을 보면서 어떻게 하면 조직이 잘 적응을 할수 있는 조직이 될수 있을까에 대해서 많이 연구를 해왔고, 그런 부분들이 좀 회사에 좀 이제 문화적으로 작용을 하고 있지 않을까 생각을 하고 있습니다. 결국에는 돌아보면 회사 자체가 계속 이제 이런 상황들에 적응해온 과정이라고 생각을 하는데, 초반에는 당연히 자본력도 약했고, 어떤 이 산업에 대한 관심과 이제 창업에 대한 열정이 있었지, 산업적인 인사이트가 막 있지도 않고 하다 보니까, 아무래도 좋은 브랜드를 찾아서 제가 봤던 해외 시장으로 뭔가 진출할 수 있는데 우리가 역할을 할수 있지 않을까라는 처음 생각을 했던 것 같고, 이제 그 과정에서 이 산업이, 이제 우리 회사가 좀더 서스테이너블 하려면, 우리 회사가 우리 브랜드를 가져야겠구나라는 생각을 자연스럽게 하게 됐고, 저희 이제 브랜드를 만들게 됐고요. 그리고 브랜드를 저희가 이제 알려가는 과정에서 아까 말씀드렸던 이제 여러 패러다임적인 도전을 하기 위해서는, 이제 우리가 컨텐츠도 같이 만들어야겠다는 생각을 하고, 저희는 이제 브랜드 컨텐츠 회사가 됐고요. 그리고 이제 브랜드, 좋은 브랜드, 좋은 컨텐츠를 만들기 시작하면서 되게 자연스럽게, 그럼 고객분들이 모여서 더 좋은 이제 나은 이제 쇼핑 경험까지 드릴 수 있도록 이제 커머스 회사로 계속 좀 적응해온 과정이라고 생각을 하고 있습니다. 해외에서 오셔서, 한국에 오셔서 저희 제품을 구입해 가시는 분들이 막 점점 늘어나고 있던 시기였는데, 이분들이 아무래도 뭐 저희 제품만이 아니라 여러 브랜드를 가지고 있는 리테일에서 경험을 하시다 보니까 뭐전 제품을 사실 보실 수 없을 때도 많고, 그다음에 여기에서 좀 브랜드에 대한 얘기를 사실 상담하기도 좀 쉽지가 않고 한 경험들을 이제 제가 아까 말씀드린 것처럼 관찰하고 이런 걸 좋아하는데, 좀 보면서 고객분들이 오셔서 좀더 좋은 브랜드 경험을 하면 좋겠다라는 생각으로 이제 구상을 시작을 했고요. 저희가 그렇게 할수 있는 좀 기회가 돼서 이제 클래스워를 만들면서 요즘에 갖고 있는 생각은, 이런 오프라인 공간도 되게 좋은 브랜드 미디어가 될수 있지 않을까라고 좀 생각을 하고 있어요. 네. 일단 저희가 흔히 생각하는 화장품 오프라인 매장이라고 하면, 사실 자주 갈 이유는 없는 곳이거든요. 사실 뭐 제품이 마음에 들거나 브랜드가 마음에 들면 그다음부터는 온라인에서도 구매를 충분히 할수 있는 환경이기 때문에, 그렇다면 이제 오프라인 공간에서 어떤 경험들을 줘야 될까라는 게 저희가 기획하면서 제일 많이 고민했던 거고, 그래서 단순히 화장품만 구매하는 공간이 아니라 좀 다른 공간에 다른 컨텐츠가 자리하면 좋겠다라는 생각으로 저희가 총 5개층짜리 공간을 만들게 됐던 거죠.
Sales and marketing manager for Wishtrend.com. And to briefly introduce what Wishtrend is, it's a beauty e-commerce that strives to provide customers with healthy and effective skincare solutions. And yeah, our team's ultimate goal is to make Wishtrend globally grow by interacting with customers through skincare content and curation. Because we're based in South Korea, we don't really have the knowledge nor the resources to be as trendy as the local brands. So what we do is try to be as interactive as possible. And to do this, first we use our social media platforms and our Wishtrend YouTube channel. And as many of you know, we have our in-house YouTube channel called Wishtrend TV. And we have two social media platforms, Wishtrend and Wishtrend Story. And we have our blog editorial called Glam. So we use these platforms as a source to listen to our customers and understand what customers primarily want. And the second thing is we reach out to diverse influencers. So we have around 3,000 affiliate partners all around the world right now. And we, by engaging with them and interacting with them, we gain insight, and they help us, explore our journey in the skincare community. I think diversity is very important. Even though we're based in South Korea, we try to use people that aren't only in Korea, but models from outside of Korea. Plus, like I said, we interact with customers as much as possible. So we try to understand their needs, and that's how we produce our content. That's where we get our ideas. So I think that's maybe the reason why our YouTube channel is successful. Yeah. I think a few years back, some of the feedbacks we got was about ingredient lists, because skincare community, that they can be kind of vocal about I want these ingredients in my skincare and all that stuff, right? But nowadays I can see the trend shifting to being eco-friendly, sustainable. Is it non-plastic? Is this recyclable? And although many brands are pretty aware of this and they're very conscious of this, but it's really hard to incorporate these keywords into the brand immediately. But just gaining these little small feedbacks, it really helps us. It's very eye-opening for us to understand what the customers primarily want when purchasing and what they value in purchasing. So yeah, these are some of the feedbacks that we get these days.
My name is Dino, and I'm the founder of MimiBox. And today we call ourselves MBX. It's a shorter version of our company. And I've been running the company for 9 years now. It all started at Parsons, many internships, and then got a job at Tom Ford, and then worked there for a few years. I was a PR assistant. What I did as a PR assistant was that I'll deal with the all the media outlets, GQ, Esquire, Vanity Fair, representing the brand. I would also do a lot of celebrity dressing. I did 007, James Bond, Brad Pitt, David Beckham, Valentino, Shia LaBeouf, the guy from Transformers. Yeah, there were so many celebrities that I got to meet with while I was there. So that's how my early career after Parsons has evolved. After I left Tom Ford, I came back to Korea. And then I joined a 2-month-old startup called Tmon. T-M-O-N. It's an e-commerce company that does about $3 billion in transactions on an annual basis now. It's like in the movies. We're creating this startup that did phenomenally well, and we were trying to build the Amazon of Korea. During the journey, the company got sold to Living Social for $300 million. So after that, after it was acquired, I left the company again, and then thought, okay, how do I do something interesting with the experience that I've had? Tom Ford, where I got the little experience of fashion and beauty, as well as some sunglasses and movie as well. But that and my experience at the e-commerce company, which was very successful. And can we do something in fashion and technology or beauty and technology? I was like, okay, I've tried fashion, so let's try beauty, which I thought was gonna be important for Korea, because you know, Korea had the theme of they were betting on a few places, and one was entertainment, which we know as K-pop today. One, the other was food, and the third pillar was beauty. So I was like, okay, let's do something with beauty and technology, and start a company. While it may seem like you know, I'm trying to make things look logical, it was just, you know, myself and a couple of friends with $8,000 that we got to start their journey. So yeah, that's what the beginning looked like. The first product that we did was subscription box business. There was a startup called Birchbox from New York City. I got to talk to the founders once, and I thought that it would be a great product for Korea as well, or the target audience of Korea. With the $8,000 capital that we have, we launched our website in 71 days. I coded the website. I had a co-founder, which was a friend of mine. He would do sales. And then we put these products together and sold them online for $15. It was a very humble beginning, but the first product did really well. First month was, you know, even though it's a $15 product, we were able to get the revenue up to about $20,000. The second month was around $50,000, and the third month was $150,000. We bootstrapped the company. You know, no one wanted to fund us, right? You know, not even our parents. No one really believed that this could take off. But it really took off from the very start. You know, we thought that we were solving a beauty discovery problem that the consumers had, right? How can you try different brands and new brands as well as different products by just paying $15 a month and it gets delivered to your house? You know, given that, you know, Korea is a very competitive market with thousands of new brands being born every year, I think the solution was great. But we evolved to be a mobile commerce company next. So what I mean by mobile commerce was that we were, after that first product, we're building the mobile version of Sephora in Korea, which had about 4,500 brands and 4 million customers monthly. And then on the third year, there came a opportunity where one of the Silicon Valley VCs, a venture capitalist called Y Combinator, had made a visit to Korea. Until then, we were just bootstrapped. You know, just friends and family running the business. YC comes along and tells us, hey, what you guys are doing is phenomenal, but you should be in the US. You should have your product in the US, and you should come to Silicon Valley if you're serious about building a great company. And we became the first company that YC ever invested in Korea. So that there, and we, because of that investment, we also thought about the product, because everything that we're building were for you know, people of Korea, but how can we look at the global market and build a product that's going to resonate with everyone? And K-beauty was the keyword that we gravitated around. What K-beauty means for the world is not that it's just a fun experience. The price point, the skincare technology, everything that was only existed in the bubble of Korea could, you know, go global was something that we envisioned. So since the first investment from YC, our just dreams got bigger and bigger. We eventually, you know, raised more than $200 million of venture capital money, which involve strategic names like Chanel and Johnson & Johnson. So we've really come, far and way more than we expected. And I mean, today, our goal is to, how can we build an experience of K-beauty that's gonna resonate with the next generation of consumers around the world? we feel like we're still in the early innings of that. Yeah, that was the YC's investment that made our headquarter change to San Francisco, right? It's not only the capital that was meaningful to us, it was something, it was more than that, people having belief in you, and we can address the largest market in the world. I mean, US market is not US market, it's a global market. Like any global company can do operations here. That inspiration really triggered us to move here. I wasn't born here, but for you to have a successful business, you need to understand the people, right? Why are people interested in XYZ? Why are they buying things? What's the competitive landscape look like? Everything was very difficult, right? Even for me, like the language also was something, that I had to pick up on and perhaps learn as much as I can. Even though I worked at Tom Ford and Parsons, running a beauty technology company was something that was very different. Being a CEO was something that was very different. Every day was a challenge, but what's good about Silicon Valley and the culture here is that it's very open, right? People understand that you're new, but they expect you to learn fast, right? So as long as you have that tenacity and the will, I think eventually people do understand, and perhaps I think now we're in a better position than when we were when we first opened our San Francisco office, which was about 7 years ago. I mean, we thought about it for a long time, but we didn't want to change too much from what we did initially. So we brought the subscription model. It was very successful, but we've learned that there's a bigger opportunity for us to create our own brands. We eventually started to create our own brands because we had more data around the customers, and we thought that all K-beauty product, because we were only featuring K-beauty brands at the time, most of the operations were done in Korea for these brands. While we had our foot in the ground, we knew we were talking to our customers, and we knew where the opportunities were. The only thing that we didn't know at the time was how to create a product, how to create a brand. That was a very difficult learning for us, but we've learned that. And now we think that fast forward to today, we have K-beauty brands that has a better product market fit for people here or people globally. In the US, customers tend to look for a product that solve a problem. In Korea, people tend to look for more the brand name versus the product. The approach of discovering a beauty product is very different. So with the two different philosophies, in Korea, the brands emphasize the brand name more than the product name. Here, product name and what it does is way more important, right? It's still those little nuanced differences that you have to understand as a brand builder to grow. And there are many examples like that we do internally. While we market ourselves as a K-beauty company, everything is designed around the customers, except for the innovation part, which means the formula, the ingredients, which are all done in Korea, because I think that's the strength of our company. Everything else is something that we look at customers' data, we look at what people are into, and then we try to adopt that to our products and brands. I can give you two examples. We have a portfolio of brands that we operate. Three skincare, three color lines, so makeup lines. I can give you one example for each. Let me start off with I Do Care, which is a skincare line. We co-developed that with a retailer called Ulta. Ulta has about 1,200 stores nationwide here in the US, and it's a public company. And it's one of the largest retailers in the US. When we sat down with them, because The reason that we co-developed, or we asked them if you could co-develop with us, was because we lacked the understanding of the people here. And one thing that we learned at the time was that skincare penetration was really low. Then, and this is in 2017. As well as whatever was trending in Korea 4 years ago would hit the coast, west coast of the US 4 years after. So we went to the labs, the skincare labs, and then told them, hey, tell us what was trending 4 years ago that we could reinvent for the beginners of skincare in the US. And we will launch it on Ulta. So iDoCare, we started off with the category of masks, facial masks. And at the time, here in the US, when we did the survey, 86% of the customers have never tried a facial wash-off mask. 86%. So we had to name the brand, interestingly enough, so that people can try it. We had to name the product, interesting enough, so they want to try it. Like, if you're trying something new, you're not going to try something serious, right? So that's why we named our first product Disco Kitten. There's a, which we call the Kitten series, Disco Kitten, Sugar Kitten, Space Kitten, and Mini Meow Trio, which is the sample size version of the three masks that I just mentioned. They became an enormous hit, right? People loved it. And the formula was on spot. The retailer had nationwide distribution. It was online and 1,200 stores nationwide. The brand was very fun. So at the time, if we go through the iDoCare hashtags Instagram, people will be saying, hey, do you want to do next Netflix night? Or do you want to do masking night? And iDoCare's name would always come up. So we've learned that, you know, we're competing with Netflixes of the world versus other skincare brands, because we were bringing that fun and efficacious experience to the customers here. That was, I would say that's one of the example. And the other was, would be a brand name called Kaja, K-A-J-A. It's a Korean name and it means let's go. So this one, we co-developed it with Sephora. Yeah, it took us like almost 4 years to convince that, you know, and Sephora to be convinced that they want to work with us, like a small company like ours. And how the conversation started was that Sephora's, price point is pretty high, right? If you go into their stores, it's usually above $30 and it can go up to like $150 or $100 or $80. What they wanted to do was that they wanted to bring in Gen Z customers through the brand that we'll invent together. We were like, okay, let's make the price point affordable enough, right? So $25 to $35 range. And let's make it a color brand. And let's make it really interesting on the content front so that we have more digital, we have a better digital experience as well as more online sales. And let's do something that's quite the opposite of what the market was doing. Meaning everyone was like, this was like 2018, about 3 years ago, everyone was creating like these large palettes. We named the brand and we gravitated around portability. Because of the name Let's Go, instead of making large palettes, we made a really small stacked eyeshadow called Beauty Bento, which became number one at Sephora. So with these, I hope that you understand what I mean, you know, what we were trying to do with these two different brands and try to solve a problem that the customers will look for in the near future. Those two brands are now very, very successful. I have to thank our partners, innovation labs, our retailers, but we are all trying to create something that people want. We think there are four pillars to it. One is the customer-centric mindset. All K-beauty companies or brands in Korea have the customer-centric mindset because it's such a competitive market, right? Per capita spending on the female, side, it's about we are the second or the third in the world. We have the largest men's market, men's cosmetic market in the world. You know, given our population, it's very hard to believe that we're the largest. For men's market, we're much bigger than US and China. So everyone has to be customer centric, or everyone has to obsess around the customers, or you're gonna be behind. The second is that the product innovation and speed to market, right? Because you're so customer centric minded, your product has to be innovative enough and you have to get it out to the market as quickly as possible. Number third pillar is that you not only have to be great at product and bring it to the market as quickly as possible, you have to build a different experience around that. Meaning the packaging might be different, right? The content might be different, or the application or how to apply the products might be different. You have to have one more thing that's gonna improve the experience of the brand. And the fourth pillar is the price point. I think K-beauty is about what they call the democratizing the beauty world. How do you bring a great technology at an economical price point? And we gravitate around those four pillars. Even though we, like I said, we say like K-beauty, we're a K-beauty company, we try to hone in on every single pillar and make sure that we bring each value to the customers. And they think, oh, I'm getting a great product, an innovative product that's on trend, as well as the price point is phenomenal. And I think that's what K-beauty is about. The K-beauty trend itself, or the culture trend itself, I think will continue to grow because we are seeing early innings of K-pop and K-food, K-drama. I think that's really conquering the world. So there is going to be a halo effect from that for K-beauty as well. The business, we had two different strategies. One was inside out and outside in. Inside out is just making sure that the company survives. There was tremendous haircut on the top line revenue. The world was changing upside down in terms of revenue stream. So we looked into, you know, financials. We only made necessary investments. We're just keeping low. We ditched our annual forecast. We're like, okay, don't think about the annual forecast. Let's make sure that we survive through this period. That's the strategy one called inside out. The second piece that we did was the outside in, which was, you know, because the pandemic is such a global impact, you know, we knew that the consumers were going to change. Meaning that, you know, consumers are going to shop more online. You know, our products now have to accelerate our transition to vegan, cruelty-free, PETA registration. Because if you think about where the possibility of a pandemic coming from an animal, you know, I think had an entire mindset change to the people. Outside in was more about how do we prepare ourselves for post-recovery? How do we prepare ourselves for post-pandemic and make sure that we're building for the future, not just survival like we talked about in inside out strategy. Fortunately, the pandemic has been with us for a year now, and we're able to balance those two things out well. We're not only surviving, but we're also making a lot of changes internally on a process-wise so that we're leaning into the future. We now have more online sales. We now have more products that are vegan, cruelty-free. We completely got rid of our outer packaging because we knew that sustainability was something that people will always keep in mind. And one other event that really triggered under the change that made us change our company values was the Black Lives Matter. I know Stop Asian Hate is something that's going on today. So that also helped us think about how do we do our campaigns? You know, what are the ambassadors that we should work with? What's our team composition look like? So those are some of the outside-in changes that we had to go through as well. when we were developing Kaja, because the skin tones are very different, right? And so we had to bring our employees from here to Korea, and then they stayed at Airbnbs for 3 months. They loved it, right? Because Seoul is such a fun city. And every time we were developing a new color, they had to travel and then try it on their skin, right? So that the payoff comes right. It's what we expected in terms of the color. It's what we expected in terms of the texture. So we are team members, you know, proactively traveled and then applied it on us so that it's you know, at the end of the day, the customer experience is improved. And skin color was definitely a challenging piece. Like the mission of like, let's bring K-beauty to the world. Today, we generate maybe less than 20% of our revenue in Korea, even though that was our first market. Our largest market is here in the US, which is about 45%. This year, we expanded to Japan, and also we plan to expand to Europe in the second half of 2021. Yeah, our mission has not stopped and will continue to reach as many customers as possible who see value in what we're doing. In the past, you know, 9 years, I feel like I've really never looked sideways and never looked back and continued running forward. And that's something that I'm proud of, but at the same time, there are some decisions that I thought that I should have not made. And that is, you know, seizing the subscription service in Korea. At the time, because of our limited resources and subscription, while it was growing fast, it didn't grow fast enough to support our scale. And now our company is very stable and is very stable financially and strategically, I feel like. So we reviewed our past 9 years and thought about, okay, what are some of the missed opportunities? What are some of the things that people loved and that, you know, we made a decision as a company that we should have not? And I think subscription was one of them. So we relaunched our subscription service in January 2021, just for Korea. And it's doing really well. We plan to bring that to other markets, including the US, very soon. Our company has a great demand. It's interesting because you bring this up. We're very short on our supply today because the demand is growing faster than we expected. Not sure why in 2021, but you know, since the 2020, we had a very good growth, but 2021, we are seeing another humongous growth. And I think it may be the, you know, people, you know, some parts of the, you know, US, they've loosened the restrictions around travel. Right, or they've loosened the restrictions around, you know, out dining outside. So we're seeing a great demand there. And we're also launching about 150 products this year. Right, so if you think about that magnitude, we are launching a new product every 3 days. Inside the company, it's really crazy. Everything is moving at like 50 miles per hour. But, you know, I think we're doing a good job. We're catching up. We have a great team. Yeah, one thing that's not super favorable for us today is that because we manufacture all of our products in Korea, and that's what we believe that we should do in the future as well, the logistics cost between Korea and outside world, or the trade cost, meaning the logistics expenses around the world, has really gone up, whether it's by air or whether it's by boat. Because there was less trade during the pandemic, the logistics cost really went up. So that's not something beneficial today, but I'm sure as things get back to normal, the cost will go down. So recently I read, when we were developing our outside-in strategy, how do we make sure that we lean into the future? I read a lot of reports around, you know, what people will care in the future. I mean, 90% of the customers would like to save the world, was the statement. right? So every single customer that we'll serve in the future or even now, when they're making a purchase decision, it's not like, oh, I just want a beauty product, right? I want a, you know, I want color on my lips. It's just gonna be, you know, I want color on my lips, I want a great lipstick, but, you know, my purchase is a value-driven decision and I want to save the world by buying this lipstick, right? So it's something that we need to work on as a company, because the technology behind all that is very, you know, needs to be updated and needs to be improved. My personal belief is that I think beauty can be more fun. Every product, every brand in the world, if they sell at Sephora, they're efficacious in some way, right? It's gonna be effective to you in some way. But what's gonna drive you to buy this product versus that, I think is the fun experience, right? We want a brand and product that we, you know, like in the morning you wake up and you look forward to trying it on, right? Not sure if that's gonna be possible, but rather than like, you know, it becoming a commodity, this is an experiential product and brand that I just want to continue to try. So I hope we get there, and we're trying our best to be there.